Good evening and welcome to Evensong this Palm Sunday evening, or as our prayer books would have it, the Sunday next before Easter. Our first hymn is hymn number 727, When I Survey the Wondrous Cross. It's lovely to have Chris here for his first in-post Evensong. He did sneak in and join us for one before he was interviewed. But it's great to have you here this evening and preaching, and next time you'll be doing the whole lot, I think. So a verse from page 16. To the Lord our God belong mercies and forgivenesses, though we have rebelled against him. Neither have we obeyed the voice of the Lord our God to walk in his laws, which he set before us. O Lord, correct me, but with judgment, not in thine anger, lest thou bring me to nothing. Dearly beloved brethren, the scripture moveth us in sundry places to acknowledge and confess our manifold sins and wickedness, and that we should not dissemble nor cloak them before the face of Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, but confess them with an humble, lowly, penitent, and obedient heart, to the end that we may obtain forgiveness of the same by his infinite goodness and mercy. And although we ought at all times humbly to acknowledge our sins before God, yet ought we most chiefly so to do when we assemble and meet together to render thanks for the great benefits that we have received at his hands, to set forth his most worthy praise, to hear his most holy word, and to ask those things which are requisite and necessary as well for the body as the soul. Wherefore I pray and beseech you, as many as are here present, to accompany me with a pure heart and humble voice unto the throne of the heavenly grace. And we sit or kneel and say together, Almighty and most merciful Father, we have erred and strayed from thy ways like lost sheep. We have followed too much the devices and desires of our own hearts. We have offended against thy holy laws. We have left undone those things which we ought to have done, and we have done those things which we ought not to have done. And there is no health in us. But thou, O Lord, have mercy upon us, miserable offenders. Spare thou them, O God, which confess their faults. Restore thou them that are penitent, according to thy promises, declared unto mankind in Christ Jesus our Lord. And grant, O most merciful Father, for his sake, that we may hereafter live a godly, righteous, and sober life, to the glory of thy holy name. Amen.
Almighty God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who desireth not the death of a sinner, but rather that he may turn from his wickedness and live, and hath given power and commandment to his ministers to declare and pronounce to his people, being penitent, the absolution and remission of their sins. He pardoneth and absolveth all them that truly repent and unfeignedly believe his holy gospel. Wherefore, let us beseech him to grant us true repentance and his Holy Spirit, that those things may please him which we do at this present, and that the rest of our life hereafter may be pure and holy, so that at the last we may come to his eternal joy. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. In thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Our psalm this evening is Psalm 69. It begins on page 429. It carries on till about 431 or two, but we are only going to do the first 14 verses. So Psalm 69, verses 1 to 14.
Thank you.
Please be seated for our Old Testament reading, which you can follow in the yellow pew sheet.
The Old Testament reading is taken from Isaiah, chapter 5, verses 1 to 7. Let me sing for my beloved my love song concerning his vineyard. My beloved had a vineyard on a very fertile hill. He dug it and cleared it of stones, and he planted it with choice vines. He built a watchtower in the midst of it, and hewed out a wine vat in it. He expected it to yield grapes, but it yielded wild grapes. And now, inhabitants of Jerusalem and people of Judah, judge between me and my vineyard. What more was there to do for my vineyard that I had not done in it? When I expected it to yield grapes, why did it yield wild grapes? And now I will tell you what I will do with my vineyard. I will remove its hedge, and it shall be devoured. I will break down its wall, and it shall be trampled down. I will make it a waste. It shall not be pruned or hoed, and it shall be overgrown with briars and thorns. I will also command the clouds that they rain no rain upon it. For the vineyard of the Lord of hosts is the house of Israel, and the people of Judah are his pleasant planting. He expected justice, but saw bloodshed, righteousness, but heard a cry. Here ends the first reading.
We continue with the Magnificat, which begins at the bottom of page 19.
Thank you.
Please be seated for the New Testament reading.
The New Testament reading is taken from Mark chapter 12, verses 1 to 12. Then he began to speak to them in parables. A man planted a vineyard, put a fence around it, dug a pit for the winepress, and built a watchtower. Then he leased it to tenants and went away to another country. When the season came, he sent a slave to the tenants to collect from them his share of the produce of the vineyard. But they seized him and beat him and sent him away empty-handed. And again he sent another slave to them. This one they beat over the head and insulted. Then he sent another, and that one they killed. And so it was with many others. Some they beat, and others they killed. He had still one other, a beloved son. Finally, he sent him to them, saying, "They will respect my son." But those tenants said to one another, "This is the heir. Come, let us kill him, and the inheritance will be ours." So they seized him, killed him, and threw him out of the vineyard. What then will the owner of the vineyard do? He will come and destroy the tenants and give the vineyard to others. Have you not read this scripture? The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. This was the Lord's doing, and it is amazing in our eyes. When they realized that he had told this parable against them, they wanted to arrest him, but they feared the crowd, so they left him and went away. Here ends the second lesson.
And we stand to sing the Nunc Dimittis. We say together the Apostles' Creed, which begins at the bottom of page 22. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The collect for the Sunday next before Easter. Almighty and everlasting God, who of thy tender love towards mankind hast sent thy Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ, to take upon him our flesh and to suffer death upon the cross, that all mankind should follow the example of his great humility, mercifully grant that we may both follow the example of his patience and also be made partakers of his resurrection, through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Amen. The Collect for Ash Wednesday. Almighty and everlasting God, who hatest nothing that thou hast made and dost forgive the sins of all them that are penitent, create and make in us new and contrite hearts, that we, worthily lamenting our sins and acknowledging our wretchedness, may obtain of thee, the God of all mercy, perfect remission and forgiveness, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. O God, from whom all holy desires, all good counsels, and all just works do proceed, give unto thy servants that peace which the world cannot give, that both our hearts may be set to obey thy commandments, and also that by thee, we being defended from the fear of our enemies, may pass our time in rest and quietness. Through the merits of Jesus Christ, our Saviour. Amen. We say the third collect together. Lighten our darkness, we beseech thee, O Lord, and by thy great mercy, defend us from all perils and dangers of this night, for the love of thy only Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
And it gives me great pleasure to announce the notices. The first notice, the most important one, is that the clocks go forward next Sunday. So you get an hour less in bed. So you've now got no excuse for being late because you now know what the time is. This coming week, we have reflection services at 7 o'clock every evening. And they begin here tomorrow evening at 7 o'clock. Then it's Tilstock on Tuesday evening at 7, and then Falls on Wednesday. And the notices are all here. I'm presuming that everyone has signed up for the Easter breakfast already who want to come. Yep. Excellent. I'm looking forward to seeing as many people there as possible. You might have eaten all the food by the time I get there, because there is a BCP service next week at 8 o'clock. It's not the first Sunday of the month, but it is Easter Sunday. So if you know anyone who normally comes to the 8 o'clock, they might not know, so please tell them. Don't assume that they know. Any other notices? Excellent. Thank you.
Our anthem this evening is a very beautiful hymn, O Christ, who art the light and day, thou drivest darksome night away. It's a wonderful prayer for our safekeeping through the night.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Dear Lord, as we gather this evening on a day when we remember confusion about your message, we share our confusion, those events which do not match up to our hopes and dreams in this world, in this life which you have given us. We long for peace in the world, Lord. We pray always for peace in the world, and yet the world does not seem to be getting any more peaceful. Make us peacemakers, Lord. Make all of us peacemakers. Help us celebrate the small moments of success that we have so that we don't lose hope. Give us wisdom, Lord, to understand how to tackle inequality and injustice so that the language of your love can be heard by all. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those who suffer because another is greedy or violent. Where we can help, give us the courage to do so. And we pray for those who cause suffering, for their lives to be turned around, for your love to overwhelm them. Lord, in your mercy, we pray for the communities to which we belong. We give thanks for all that is good about them. Help us to sustain them, to be welcoming to newcomers, and to embrace change where it is for the good. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for our schools and those who learn and work in them, especially as they approach the Easter holidays. We pray for rest for those who need it, for safety for those who need it, for joy with family and friends, and for time to think. Lord, in your mercy, we pray for our churches, for those who learn and pray in them, those who lead in them, and those who visit them. We pray that by our labours as your children, this space which we call St. Alkmund's can be known as a place of outreaching love, a place where comfort can be experienced, where awe and wonder of your being is known. We pray with and for those who have left prayers on our prayer board. This week we pray for Susie as she deals with the challenges she is currently facing. We pray for Betty, who misses her mum, and for someone who misses Dexter, their pet. And we pray for Frieda and Alison, our link missionaries, and for their work. We give thanks for the connection with them, which takes us beyond the parish in our thinking and our care. We pray too for those who work for the other charities that we support and for those whose lives they seek to improve. Lord, in your mercy, we give thanks for those who lead areas of the work done in your name, those who organise rotas, those who take on new projects, those who are responsible for the direction and priority of learning and outreach. We pray for those who minister when they're also managing stress in other areas of their life or dealing with ill health. Help us to treat them with kindness and understanding and to be willing to take on a share of the burden. And we pray for those who step into new roles, especially if they do so with reluctance. And we pray for those in leadership who take a wrong turn. We pray for them and for those they have hurt, as we pray for ourselves and those we have hurt. We give thanks for your mercy, Lord. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for those who are sick, mentally or physically, and give thanks for those who are part of their care and healing. We pray for those who we are particularly worried about, and for those who we have been asked to pray for as a church, that they will know your healing presence in their lives. And we mention by name Steve White, Oliver Knott, Harry, Isaac, Frieda Caulfield, Wendy's family, Alison, Kenny, Sarah and baby Orla, George Jones, Audrey, Kath Williams, and Paulie. Lord, in your mercy. We give thanks, Lord, for the wonder and promise of eternal life with you. We pray for those who have died and those who mourn them, that they will be comforted by your unstoppable love. We remember especially amongst those who have died recently: Pat Jones, Margaret Rouse, Shirley Lakin, and Nancy, Laura's grandmother. Lord, in your mercy. And finally, we pray for each other in the words of the grace. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Ghost be with us all evermore. Amen. Our next hymn is hymn number 300. I heard the voice of Jesus say. Hymn number 300.
May I speak in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. Now, you may find it helpful to have the pew sheets, because it's very, very rare that you get right in front of you a beautiful example of Jesus using the prophets in his parables. If you're listening carefully, you will have noticed the similarities between Isaiah chapter 5, verses 1 to 7, and Mark chapter 12, verses 1 to 12. The vineyard, the fence, the watchtower. But what is this about? What is Jesus using the words of Isaiah for? Before we get to that, I want you to hold your palm up, because it's Palm Sunday. So hold your palm up for me. Yeah? And why am I doing this? It's not because I've lost the plot completely. It's because during COVID, we couldn't actually have palm crosses. We couldn't have Palm Sunday in church. So one of the things that we did, where I was before, was to actually write 2020 on our palms and to hold them up to the screen. And that was Palm Sunday with a difference. And the reason I tell you that is because I want you to remember Palm Sunday every day, not just when you have the palm and you've met the donkey. Because Palm Sunday is Jesus teaching us what kind of leader he really is. And he's doing it again in this parable. We notice that in Isaiah, God wants people who are grapes. And some translations are much worse than this one. This says wild grapes. Others say useless grapes. Why were the people useless grapes? Because they do not do what God wants them to do. And this is Isaiah before Isaiah is called in chapter 6 to go and deliver his real message, before the coal is put on his lips, and before he says, "Here I am, Lord, send me." This is Isaiah just being gentle. And yet still, it is not the God that we like to hear. It is the God that wants justice, that expects bloodshed. Why is Jesus using this? What, quite frankly, is unpleasant to read? It's because he's teaching the Sanhedrin a lesson. He's teaching them how they will treat him. The people who were in the vineyard think that they own it. And as people are sent to claim it rightfully, their level of violence escalates. At first, they just seize someone and beat them. Very soon, that isn't enough. They then kill, and kill again and again and again. And then he sends his beloved son. His beloved son, who is the heir to the vineyard. What do they do with him? You know the answer because you've heard it this evening. They kill him. But why do they kill him? They kill him because without an heir, the inheritance, the vineyard, goes to the people who are occupying it. They think that by killing him, they will be victorious. So they kill the heir. But they're wrong, aren't they? Very, very wrong. Because Jesus is the beloved son. Jesus is the stone that the builders rejected, the cornerstone. And it's his leadership, his lordship and his kingship that is ushered in by him being killed. The challenge for us is that if Jesus came today, we like to think that we'd embrace him with open arms, that we'd shake his hand, that we'd welcome him in to our vineyard. But if we really challenge ourselves and question in here, in our hearts, would we be just as likely to reject Jesus as these people in the vineyard? Would we be just as likely to treat Jesus as a terrorist, as someone who's far too radical, and not welcome him as we should? And would we actually crucify Jesus once again? Would we imprison him, mock him, ridicule him? It's not a nice thought, I know. But that's why we need to remember the message of this parable, that the God that we love is the same God of the Old Testament as the New, and that Jesus will often come unexpectedly and will challenge us, and that our response needs to be one that is unexpected too. The people that come into this church, will we treat them like the owners of this vineyard? I'm not saying we're going to beat anyone up, because we just won't. But do we welcome people with open hearts? Or do we instinctively look them up and down, see if they're a threat, if they don't look and sound like us? We've got to remember that the vineyard is just a parable. The vineyard represents God's kingdom. We can't put a fence around it. We can't put a hedge around it and protect it for ourselves. These beautiful stone walls aren't designed to keep God's kingdom in. They're designed to allow us to worship the kingdom of God, which is everywhere. The doors that we have are not a barrier. They're a welcoming. That's what we're called to do. So remember Palm Sunday. And every time you use your hand, remember the story of Palm Sunday. Remember the parable of the vineyards. And remember that Jesus used the prophets of the Old Testament to show us that the Old Testament God is a God of love just like the New Testament. They are one and the same. We tend to divide them. A lot of people don't like hearing the Old Testament. A lot of people don't read the Old Testament because what's in there tends to challenge us. But they are one and the same God, a God who loves us deeply, a God who embraces us, who challenges us. And as we enter Holy Week, a God who wants us to be transformed. And through our transformation, we can transform others. We can transform the world that is so broken. But we need to do it together. Let's pray. Loving God, we thank you that through your parables you speak to us. You open up not only the words of the prophets, but you open up our hearts, showing us how to live in community, how to welcome strangers, and how to challenge those who try to keep your kingdom for themselves. In Jesus' name, amen.
Our next hymn is 457, My Song is Love Unknown. And we sing remembering the story of Palm Sunday, of Easter week, and being horrified by it. So may that be our song, hymn number 457.
Please bow your heads for the blessing. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be with you and all who you love. this night and always. Amen.
And our final hymn this evening is 486, a hymn to take us out beyond these walls. So happy band of pilgrims, if onward ye will tread, with Jesus as your fellow, to Jesus as your head. Hymn number 486. Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.